500 feet below the surface, at the bottom of the Bali Sea, this nautilus is staring at its reflection for the very first time. And what happens next is not what I expected. But let's rewind, because this isn't my first time using a mirror to learn more about the behaviors and adaptations of creatures that live in the ocean. Previous tests on shallow reefs revealed regression, parallel swimming, investigation, and even some signs of testing. But in the deep, where creatures live their entire lives in darkness, how will they respond when faced with their reflection for the very first time? Does the scarcity of food on the ocean floor increase competition? And what can this mirror experiment reveal about the way that deep sea creatures see, smell, and sense in order to survive? This experiment has probably never been done before. First things first though, how on earth do you even get a mirror down so deep?
So this is the deep sea mirror rig. We've got this super heavy structure, a camera, a very bright light on top, a cage full of stinky bait, and of course the most important thing, the big mirror. But this is not going to be easy because the list of problems is pretty long. Firstly, we've got to make sure we land it in the right spot. Secondly, the rig could get stuck in the rocks. Thirdly, we're probably going to get incredibly wet. And finally, as ever, we're going to deal with some really strong currents. So it's a good job that the rig does not have a really big surface area. Yeah.
Now, I know what you're thinking. At 500 feet, this isn't really the true deep sea. But given less than 1% of sunlight reaches these depths, many of the rules and requirements of deep ocean survival still apply. One creature that has mastered life down here, in this desolate environment, is the conger eel. We've recorded these African longfin conger eels many times before. They are the dominant nocturnal force in these sandy bays, capable of inhaling very large baits in a fraction of a second, and lunging at anything that moves, including their own kind. It seemed inevitable that when face to face with its reflection, this conger would react aggressively, but apparently not. Why? Well, unlike many other eels that patrol the sand at these depths, the congers have relatively large eyes, meaning vision is a sense they rely on. On these drops, congers were noticeably scarce, perhaps suggesting that seeing a shape in the mirror that perfectly mimicked their movement was causing uncertainty and making them hesitate. This hypothesis was strengthened on another drop, when unfortunately the rig went for a little dance in the current and ended up on its side. Despite seeing no conger eels for over an hour, within seconds of the rig tipping over, one appeared. Perhaps coincidence, perhaps not. At first, it ignored its reflection, but eventually seemed to catch sight of it before retreating. After gaining some confidence, it soon returned. Not to feed though, but instead to swim slowly along the length of the mirror. Curious, but cautious. In fish behavior, this side-by-side movement is known as parallel swimming. On shallow reefs, where fish biomass is high and space is limited, parallel swimming is a common form of communication. Clear signaling that doesn't risk injury or waste precious energy. Was this conger attempting the same thing, or simply reacting to the mirror through touch? Was it even sight or touch that was causing the confusion, or another sense entirely? I can't say for sure what was driving this conger's behavior, but as is often the case in the deep, where food is scarce, eventually its stomach became its decision maker. In case you were wondering, the black cage is packed full of bait. Whilst perhaps stealing attention from the mirror, without bait, drawing creatures closer would be impossible, especially those that rely so heavily on their sense of smell, like the next creature that showed up. This is a dark-shouldered snake eel. Now, these snake eels have relatively small eyes when compared to the conger eels, and also their shallower water cousins that are able to make use of the moonlight reflecting off of prey. The fancy name scientists give to this sense of smell is olfaction. Despite the absence of light, chemical cues and smells can travel for miles in water. In order to find food in this barren landscape, it makes sense that evolution favored the development of highly developed olfactory systems rather than better eyesight. However, survival isn't just about finding food, but also about avoiding predators, as we've seen many times before. Spooky. Oh, and talking of spooky, I'm pleased to announce that this video is sponsored by CyberGhost.
So guys, if you're like me and you spent way too much of your early online life not using a virtual private network or VPN, you'll definitely want to check out CyberGhost. So whilst my cameras have got eyes at the bottom of the ocean, you too are being watched, albeit online. And even incognito mode doesn't stop that.
Ants.
Your internet service provider, your school and works IT department, and even your Wi-Fi router can all track what you're doing online. But that's where CyberGhost comes in. So with CyberGhost, you simply select one of their 100 different locations before you browse to encrypt and reroute all of your online traffic through their secure servers. And this way, no one will ever know about what you're doing online.
Huh?
Big truck. Hang on. Okay, we're good. If you're a traveler like me, CyberGhost also unlocks geo-restricted games and content from over 40 different streaming platforms like Amazon Prime, Disney Plus, and Netflix. And you can even secure better deals online just by changing your virtual location. It also works on all major devices and operating systems, so Windows, Mac, Android, and iOS, and you can protect up to 7 devices and share it with friends and family. So guys, CyberGhost has given me a really good deal to share with you, but I'll read it to make sure I get the details correct. Just $2.03 a month, plus 4 months for free, which is 84% off. There's even a 45-day money-back guarantee. I've been using CyberGhost now for a few weeks, and it's a super seamless service that's trusted by over 38 million people across the globe. If you want to support the channel and also convince more brands like CyberGhost to support our deep sea adventures, go and check out the link in the description, once you finish this video of course, and check it out for yourself. And hopefully you'll be much more interested in CyberGhost than the dark-shouldered snake eel was in the mirror. So far, we've seen how fish use both vision and smell to survive. But if these aren't enough to explain what we're observing, what senses are the fish using instead? What if vision and smell aren't the most trusted senses in the deep sea? Now, nearly all fish have something called a lateral line. This is a common sensory organ that runs along the side of the fish's body, a line of pores that open into fluid-filled canals containing neuromasts, tiny clusters of sensory hair cells. The system operates through a process called mechanotransduction, which converts physical water movement into electrical signals that the brain can interpret. You can actually see the lateral lines on fish, and the system works incredibly quickly, capable of triggering an escape response in milliseconds. But I know what you're thinking. How is this relevant for the mirror experiment? Well, like us, fish are likely able to sense when something isn't right. Many fish species, like this jobfish, approach the mirror cautiously, keeping their distance. Some were likely deterred by the bright white lights, but is it also possible that despite registering a visual signal, the fact that their reflection does not trigger a lateral line response might also be the cause of caution? Let me know what you think in the comments. I drew up this hypothesis after watching footage from our shallower reef mirror tests, where frustration, perhaps caused by lateral line confusion, induced very aggressive responses. Other fish, like this starry toad, react in slightly different ways though. I'm not sure that inflating its body was really necessary, but each to their own, I guess. However, sharks and rays have an additional tool, the ampullae of Lorenzini, a sensory system that detects the faint electrical signals given off by the tissues of other creatures. This mitotic stingaree makes use of this electroreception. Unfortunately for us though, the mirror was a little too high off the bottom for us to see how powerful its other senses are. Oh, and by the way, if you're new to the channel, this mitotic stingaree is a creature we found living at the bottom of the Bali Sea that was previously thought to only live in northern Australia. We've also recorded other rare sharks, rays, and weird deep ocean life using our night vision cameras. I'm dropping these cameras all around the globe in search of a species new to science, so if you want to see what else we find lurking in the deep, make sure to hit that subscribe button. So far, the mirror test had revealed some interesting findings and sparked some curious questions. Vision can mislead, smell often dominates, and in the absence of natural signals, many species choose caution over curiosity. But there's one group of fishes that are rarely cautious. The moray eels. The mirror was approached by a number of morays over the course of several drops. Some small, some a little larger. Whilst morays have better vision than the snake eels, their vision is still pretty poor, with limited sharpness, brightness, and contrast. The first moray that approached the mirror was hesitant. Could it have seen the subtle movements of another eel in the distance? When you're this small, it should be assumed that every eel you run into is probably a threat. However, other eels were comfortable getting much closer, touching the mirror with their noses and approaching from different angles, seemingly interested in the eel staring back at them. As before, it's more likely that these eels simply register the movement of vague low-resolution shapes in the mirror, rather than a clear, detailed reflection.
but numerous subtle interactions with the mirror from multiple eels suggest that perhaps they are using their vision to some degree. It could be that the bright lights on the rig give their eyes more information. Similar behaviour was displayed in shallower water tests, where both giant and yellow-edged morays found themselves face-to-face with the mirror, flaring up and bumping into it with their pointed noses. In most cases, their interaction seemed coincidental rather than deliberate, although it must be pretty shocking to realise that that is what you look like. But again, the eels were cautious around the mirror, not aggressive.
Where's he gone? Oh, there he goes!
Why does it feel that aggression is less common in the deep? Even disagreement over cracks and crevices to hide in are pretty uneventful. However, whilst the morays didn't put on much of a show with the mirror, they were sure to do what morays do best, create an underwater horror show whilst ripping apart the bait. It's really interesting to see these morays ball up like a snake whilst feeding. They do this in part to prevent prey from escaping, but also to create leverage so they can tear off enormous chunks of flesh before swallowing them whole. When you come across free food in the deep, it's best to make the most of it. But morays don't just scavenge, they also sense moving prey. This little hermit crab was probably a little too bold for its own good, but they weren't the only shelled creatures that seemed to get in the morays' way. Of all of the interactions we've recorded on these drops, the Nautilus's behaviour around the mirror was perhaps the most interesting. Now, firstly, let's address the elephant in the room. Nautilus have extremely poor eyesight. Their eyes lack a lens and function a little bit like a pinhole camera. Light enters the eye through a tiny aperture hole, forming a dim image on the retina. Their vision likely looks a little like this: upside down, dark, blurry, grainy, and possibly narrow and desaturated. So yeah, pretty rubbish. But they're still able to perceive light contrast, and given the Nautilus's reflective shell acts like a second sun, when illuminated by the light, is it possible that its primitive eyes might register the presence of its reflection? If so, how might it react? Now, we've recorded multiple Nautilus interacting before. Interacting is probably the wrong word though, given other than coming into close proximity to feed on the squid and mackerel in the cage, they seem pretty unbothered by the presence of another creature that looks like them. In general, scavenging species like the chambered Nautilus are much less confrontational than active predators. Calories are unpredictable, so it's more sensible to avoid conflict than risk burning more energy than you can find. On previous drops, the Nautilus did feed though, using their many sensory tentacles to dig deep into the bait cage. When they're not doing that, they usually spend a lot of time being incredibly clumsy, banging into basically every hard surface in the immediate area, as well as trying to avoid predators. On the drops with the mirror, their behaviour was pretty similar. However, when face-to-face with its reflection, what this Nautilus did was pretty unexpected. After its reflection appeared in the mirror for the first time, the Nautilus appeared to move away from it. But then, it turned around. In typical Nautilus fashion though, it put the brakes on a little too late. At this point, the Nautilus just sat there, and showed zero interest in the bait in the cage. Based on the angle of the camera, it's difficult to tell whether, at this point, it's capable of seeing a bright white beacon staring back at it in the mirror. Although, after some time, it headed closer. Was it going in for a closer look? Possibly, although I guess also likely that the Nautilus was just using the mirror as a solid surface to lean on, which, given their other weird behaviours, would definitely fit their character. Either way, it was either staring or resting for quite a while, before being interrupted by a ravenous snake eel that woke it from its slumber. Again, of all the directions it could have headed in, it picked probably the worst one. Now, unlike fish, Nautilus do not have a lateral line to confuse them when faced with their reflection. They also likely don't engage in parallel swimming in the same way that fish do, although as the Nautilus swam meaningfully down the length of the mirror, it did make me wonder. However, despite the close inspection and lack of feeding, what it did next was even weirder. Like all cephalopods, Nautilus have a siphon, a tubular structure that vents water that they use for locomotion. But after settling down on the bottom again, this Nautilus started using its siphon to relentlessly, and somewhat aggressively, blow water into the sand. At first, it seemed a little coincidental, especially given shortly afterwards the Nautilus got up, scanned the mirror one more time, and disappeared off into the darkness. But then, it came back, settled back down against the mirror, and continued blowing. Now, why is this interesting? Well, I've witnessed other cephalopods display similar behaviours. Octopus will often do this when they've had enough of being bothered, like this wild coconut octopus that we filmed unscrewing the lid of a jar. It's possible that this is mainly functional, and that they do it to clear sand, rather than communicative. But I'm not convinced. And if octopuses blow sand to tell unwanted visitors to back off, is it possible that this nautilus was also doing it for the same reasons? It might be wishful thinking, but what do you think?
Guys, thanks so much for watching, and just a quick reminder that if you want to better protect your data online, unlock blocked content, and make browsing whilst travelling easier, go and check out the link in the description below to get a special discount from CyberGhost.
If you're new here, make sure to hit that subscribe button. Oh, and if you want to see what else we've recorded on our deep sea cameras, go and check out this video.